Hi, I'm Simon Willison, and I'm going to be introducing you to an open source project I've been working on for the past 3 years called Datasette. So Datasette is an open source multi-tool for exploring and publishing data, but I feel like the best way to explain what that means is to show you a demo. This is my dog, this is Cleo, and Cleo is a proud San Francisco dog. So the question I want to answer is, what is Cleo's favorite coffee shop? So the way I'm going to do that is using Dataset. I'm running Dataset here against a database of my swarm check-ins. I use Foursquare Swarm and I check into different places. And this is relatively unexciting. This is a database table. But every time I check in with Cleo, I use the wolf emoji as part of my check-in message. This is an alternative view onto that table, which joins it against venues to pull in things like the latitude and longitude, and then demonstrates a dataset plugin called Dataset Cluster Map, which shows me those points on a map. Now, since I know that check-ins with CleoN have the wolf emoji, I can filter this and say, I want everything where the shout contains that wolf emoji. And this filters down all of my check-ins to just the 359 check-ins that I made with Cleo. So this is Cleo's own check-in database. And I get a map of all the places she likes. But Dataset supports faceting. So if I'm interested in what categories of places she goes to, I can choose to facet by venue category. Now I can see that, unsurprisingly, she likes parks and dog runs, but she has been to 25 coffee shops. I'm going to click on coffee shop to filter down to those 25 check-ins. And then I'm going to facet by venue name to see which are the most common venue coffee shop names that she checks into. You can see that she's mainly a Blue Bottle girl. She's been to Blue Bottle 16 times, but she does occasionally go to Starbucks. An important thing about Dataset is that everything that you can see in the interface, you can get out as raw data. If I click the JSON link here, this is a JSON feed of all of Cleo's coffee shop check-ins. I can click CSV if I want to pull that data out and import it into something like Excel. So, super useful software for categorizing your dog's different coffee shop visits. So let's go for a slightly more serious demo. The New York Times publish on a daily basis, they publish the latest COVID-19 numbers for different US states and counties. And so I run a dataset instance publicly available, which takes this data and loads it into dataset for analysis. So here is that New York Times CSV file that they're publishing of different counties. But in this case, I've got some pre-configured facets. I'm going to drill down to just the numbers they've reported for California. Where's California? Here we go. And within California, I'm going to drill down into San Francisco County where I live. So now I have 351 rows for COVID case numbers in California. I have another plugin here called Dataset Vega, which lets me plot those on a line chart. So I'm going to do a line chart where I plot the date as a date time against those numbers of cases. And we can see a very, very unhealthy looking curve going up through the last few months. But then since this is a database filter interface, I can say, actually, give me Los Angeles County, and I can see their graph, which is even more intimidating. This is all built on top of relational database tables, which means you can do useful things like joins. So here's a table I pulled in of the US Census county populations, indexed against these things called FIPS codes. You'll notice that FIPS codes are also available in the counties data from the New York Times. So if I join those together, I can get a number of deaths per million and cases per million by looking at the cases number compared to the county populations. So you can see that the worst counties in terms of cases per million are Crowley, Colorado, Dewey, South Dakota. I often find when I dig into this that what's actually going on here is you've got a county with a large prison there and a relatively small other population, and those tend to be where the really bad coronavirus hotspots are when you're looking at cases per head of population. So this is what Dataset is. Dataset is a web application for serving any type of data that you can cram into a relational database in a way that lets people interact with it and explore it, but also gives people export options, like a way to export that data out. And incidentally, this is another example of a Dataset plugin. I have a thing called Copyable, which is a plugin that gives you data that you can copy and paste in different formats. Like if you needed a LaTeX table of cases per million, you can click up here and copy and paste this and process it that way. So a lot of the work I do with Datasette is around building these new types of plugins. But the secret sauce that makes all of this work is a database called Sqlite. If you're watching this talk, you probably use Sqlite every single day, even if you don't realize it, because Sqlite is an embedded database that's built into Android, it's built into iOS, it's used by Windows and macOS. Huge numbers of desktop applications use Sqlite as their underlying storage engine. And the characteristics that really appeal to me about Sqlite are, firstly, it's very small and very fast. More importantly, a Sqlite database is a single binary file. It's a something.db file which sits on disk, which makes it very easy to work with these files, create them, upload them places, move them around. And Datasette is built entirely on top of a sort of foundation of Sqlite. And the reason the way I came to this idea actually started over 10 years ago when I was working at the Guardian newspaper in London. So at The Guardian, we collected a huge amount of information about the world because we published graphs and maps and infographics. After I joined the newspaper, I found that the reporter who collected so much of this data had been beautifully indexing it and keeping it in Excel files on a desktop computer underneath his desk. And so we got together and thought and started talking about ways that we could share this raw data more widely. We ended up launching a thing called the Data Blog, where the idea was that any time The Guardian published a story with based on data, we would publish that data online as well. The way we did that was using Google Sheets, because it was free and it was easy to start using. But I always felt there needed to be there should be a better way of publishing this sort of mostly static data. 3 years ago, I started looking at serverless hosting, things like Google Cloud Run. And Vercel, and realize that there's this really interesting thing with these hosting providers where they are extremely inexpensive for small projects, provided you don't need a relational database. If you need a database, that requires like persisting new data and maintaining backups and so on. And that tends to be an extra something that they charge extra for. But for my use case, where I just want to publish data, I don't need a full MySQL or Postgres that's accepting writes. I just need a read-only relational database. And Sqlite, it turns out, is perfect for that. I can bundle my data up into a .db file and deploy it as part of the Docker container that contains the rest of the application code. So the sort of core idea with Datasette originally was deploying that application along with the code that it's going to present. I call this the baked data architectural pattern. So let's do another demo. Let's actually build something. The city of San Francisco have an open data portal, and my favorite file on this portal is their street tree list. This is a CSV file containing 195,000 trees. And I've got a copy of that here. And you can see it really is. It's a CSV file, and it, for each tree, it's got the species and the address and the latitude and longitude and all of this really rich data. So another tool that I've been working on is called Sqlite Utils, and it's a tool for manipulating these Sqlite databases. What I'm going to do is I'm going to use Sqlite Utils to insert that CSV file of trees into a database file. So I'm inserting into a file called trees.db in the trees table. And this will churn away for a few seconds, run through all 195,000 of those CSV rows, and load them into a Sqlite database file ready for me to start exploring with Dataset. Both Sqlite utils and Dataset are available in Homebrew. So if you type brew install dataset Sqlite utils, on my computer it'll tell me that I've already got them installed, but on your computer it should install those dependencies for you. And they're written in Python, so any way you can run Python you should be able to run these tools. Okay, so I now have a file called trees.db. It's a 50 megabyte file full of trees. I'm going to run dataset trees.db, start dataset on my laptop, and take a look. And here it is. This is that CSV file in tabular format. I'm going to try and get these on a map. So if I run dataset install dataset cluster map, this will install my cluster map plugin that I showed you earlier. Now when I run dataset again, because this data has latitude and longitude columns, it will show me all of that data on a map. So this right here is a map of tree. You can see that 16 of those trees had incorrect latitudes and longitudes on them. But you know what? Let's go a step further. Looking at this data, there are a lot of duplicate values, like Q legal status has a bunch of strings that look very similar to each other. Sqlite Utils has a tool for dealing with that. I can say Sqlite Utils extract trees.db trees and then the name of that column. So let's do Q legal status. And the library will extract that into a separate database table. So when I refresh this page, you can see that it's still got that data, but it's now hyperlinked through to another record. This is the Q legal status record. In fact, I've got an entire extra database table called Q legal status where, ooh, let's have a look at all of the significant trees. Turns out there are 1,732 significant trees in San Francisco, which I can load up on a map, which is kind of cool. There's a significant tree right here on 1449 Lake Street. I love playing with this data because you always find something new every time you duck into it. So we can run Sqlite Extracts on a few other columns. I'm going to do it on Q caretaker and Q species, I think. The other thing that would be fun is if we could search this. You'll notice that the Q address column has the names of streets in it. So I'm going to run a command sqlite-utils enable FTS on trees.db for the trees, and I want to enable it on that Q address column. So if I start dataset up again, see the result of our changes here are that Q species is now highlighted, Q caretaker is now a link as well, and at the top of the page I now get a search box. So if I want to search for, say, Grove Street in San Francisco, here is a map of all of the trees on Grove Street in a nice little line along that street right here. And I can go a step further and say, you know what, let's facet by the species and see that on Grove Street, the London Plane is the most common tree with 189 of them. And there are 39 cherry plums. Again, if I want a JSON file of just the cherry plums on Oak Street, on Grove Street, I can do that here. Because Sqlite is a SQL database, you can actually execute SQL queries directly against the database using that dataset, interface, which is safe because the database is opened in read-only mode, and they have a time limit on how long your SQL query can execute for. This actually means that you can write applications where you execute SQL from your JavaScript, pull back the results in JSON, and render them on a page. There's a ton of interesting things you can do around that. Let's do one last thing. I'm going to publish this data to the internet using a feature of dataset called the dataset publish command. So dataset publish lets me publish to different hosting providers, Cloud Run and Heroku and so on. I'm going to say dataset publish Cloud Run. And in this case, I can feed it a database file. So dataset publish Cloud Run. Trees.db, I'll set a title of San Francisco Trees, and I'm going to deploy it to a Cloud Run service called SF Trees. So I hit enter on this, and this command will now build a Docker container for dataset with the trees.db file in it. It'll upload that file to Google's cloud infrastructure, where it will build it as a Docker image. Once built, it's going to deploy it to the internet and give me back a URL. So this will probably take around about 30 seconds. And in 30 seconds time, that database that I just created from that regular CSV file by running a few commands will be available on the internet for anyone else who wants to start interacting with it. I'll leave that running in the background and talk a little bit about the rest of the project. So the dataset website at dataset.io has details not just of dataset, but of all of these other tools that I've been building around it. So I've now got 51 dataset plugins that add functionality from the map visualizations, GraphQL API, different options for authentication, all sorts of bits and pieces as plugins that you can pick and choose what's useful for your project. I also have a collection of tools I've been building for working with SQLite databases. So things for loading in CSVs, loading data from Postgres or MySQL into SQLite, interacting with APIs, the GitHub API, or Apple HealthKit databases. These are all things I've been building to try and increase that universe of things which you can load into SQLite so that you can use them with dataset. Switching back here, it looks like we're nearly done. We're setting an IAM policy and routing traffic. And so in a few more seconds, we should get a URL which we can visit to see our list of trees online. Here we go. So this right here is that database of trees. It's available online. Anyone can go and visit it. It has the JSON API. People can you can run SQL queries against it. You'll note it's missing the map. And that's because when I run dataset publish, I forgot to specify that I'd like to install the... install the dataset cluster map plugin. So if I leave that to run for a few more seconds, I'll have a new deployment of this that has that plugin installed as well. If I've piqued your interest, the place to go first is dataset.io, which incidentally is itself this is the dataset application running. If you go to /content, you'll see the databases that are powering this website. And then this right here is a custom template. Dataset supports custom templates and custom CSS, which means that you can use it as a framework for building entire websites. This site also demonstrates another tool I've been building for building search engines. So if I search for CSS, this will use a dataset plugin to search across multiple tables and show me results about CSS from the documentation, the plugins I've built, and blog entries, all sorts of bits and pieces. So take a look at this. The use case page explains some of the different things you can use dataset for. And if you want to talk to me about this, I'm going to be at Fosdem, so please feel free to get in touch with me there. You can also grab a slot in my calendar, and I'm happy to do a one-to-one video conversation with you. I'm talking about dataset and trying to understand what kind of problems you have that might be solvable using the software that I built. So thank you very much for your time. And yeah, if you have any questions, please feel free to reach out to me.